I'm Professor Shiva Panchakshari. In this video, I'm going to discuss about the use of Z and Y matrices for microwave networks. This is the second video in microwave network theory. In my first video, I explained about the symmetry of S matrix for microwave networks. So now in this video, so I'm going to discuss about the symmetry of Z and Y matrices for the same microwave networks. Okay. Let us start our discussion with the two-port network. So for a microwave network, it's very difficult to use Z and Y matrices. Because to use Z and Y matrices, we need voltage and current values at each port. In microwave networks, it's very difficult to define voltage or current for this complete port precisely. The voltage and current values change along the port. So it's a little difficult to give a unique value of voltage or current for any specific port. Secondly, it is also difficult to measure, or it is unavailability of the measuring devices for this voltage and current. So firstly, it's difficult to define a unique value of voltage and current for each port. Secondly, non-availability or unavailability of the measuring devices of voltage and current for microwave ports. Thirdly, it's very difficult to establish a perfect short circuit or a perfect open circuit for this microwave network, because the conductor we use to establish the short circuit may not be a perfect conductor at all the frequencies of the microwave signal. Secondly, the active components or devices present in the network may change this short circuit or open circuit behavior of the load. So we cannot ensure the same operation or the same behavior of the network for all the frequencies. So that's why. So we feel it's very difficult to use Z and Y matrices for the analysis of microwave network. But we can use the Z and Y matrices with predefined established conditions, like we can define voltage and current for a particular reference planes at the ports. So we cannot define V and I for the complete port, but we can define V and I uniquely for a given reference plane at each port. So if you're ensuring the complete discussion about these ports, then V and I are uniquely defined. Then Z and Y parameters can be used. And also at fixed frequency, we can establish short and open circuits to some extent. So because of these possibilities, we can use Z and Y matrices as and when necessary for understanding the behavior or working of the microwave network. So here, I'm going to show that these Z and Y matrices are symmetrical for a reciprocal microwave network. So today's discussion is to show that Z and Y matrices are symmetrical. For reciprocal microwave network. In my first video of microwave network theory, I showed that S matrix is symmetrical for the reciprocal microwave network. Now I'm going to show that Z and Y matrices are also symmetrical for this network. See, in my first video, I assumed that Z and Y matrices are already symmetrical for microwave network. Here I'm proving that concept. Okay, now I'll start my discussion with a multi-port microwave network. That means, let us consider a microwave network having multiple ports, that is the N ports. This is the typical look of a microwave port. I'm just trying to give you a visual feel of the microwave network. So this continues this way. So like this, there can be any number of ports. It continues this way. We can assume n number of ports. Yeah. Here, there's a microwave junction where all these ports are meeting, having the characteristic impedance Z0. So my discussion begins by considering a microwave network or a junction having n number of ports. And these ports are either waveguides or transmission lines like coaxial cable. So you can assume any one of these two. Waveguides are suitable for microwave frequencies. So it is better to continue the discussion by assuming that the ports are waveguides. Waveguide is a metallic structure which is either rectangular or circular, which is generally closed from outside and having air gap through which the waves propagate. Right. So these metallic structures guide the waves to propagate in a specific direction, hence the name waveguides. So now, in this waveguide, some of the ports may be sources and some the load. The purpose of any device is to supply the power to the given load from the given source. So that's why there may be one or more than one sources or one or more than one loads which are expecting the power. So according to conservation principle of energy, according to conservation principle of energy or power, whatever it is, the net power is always equal to zero. That means if I denote power by P, then the net power, net power means summation. Here I'm going to deal with total integration over the closed surface, because this is the waveguide structure, and when sources and loads are connected, the complete structure will be closed, right? So then the power, which is generally a vector quantity here, can give us this relation. Here P stands for P total, total power. So that means if you add all the power values in the waveguide structure and add them, you will end up with zero. So energy neither be created nor be destroyed. Then how do you get zero? Because my assumption is here, some of the powers are from generators and some of them for load. Generator powers are inputted, load powers are accepted. So taking the power input as positive, power delivered to the load as negative, if you add all of them, total power is zero. So all the inputted power will be generally delivered to the loads. So no power will be wasted here. But according to the electromagnetic field theory, so whenever you consider power at electromagnetic frequencies, the power exists in three forms. That is, your P can be either power dissipated in the network, or power stored in the network, or power propagating in the form of waves. It's a traveling wave power. So the power exists in three different forms. The power is generally dissipated if the network is having resistance. Power is stored if it is having inductance and capacitance. If not, the power will be propagating from one port to another port. So power is transferred from one port to another port through the junction in the form of electromagnetic waves. They are called traveling waves in this discussion. So power will be distributed in these three forms, right? To keep our discussion very simple, what I am going to do, I assume myself that the complete junction is having no resistance. Then the complete network or device becomes lossless. And I'll assume that no inductive and capacitive elements are present. That means no storage takes place. No storage takes place. So let us assume no R, no L, and no C in the junction along with the port, so that we can confine our discussion only to the traveling waves, the power in the form of traveling waves. So then I can introduce the equation of traveling wave into this P, into this P. As per the discussions we generally do in transmission lines, at any point of transmission, we can find two waves traveling in opposite directions. So one is incident wave, another one is reflected wave. So totally a traveling wave is generally sum of incident and reflected wave. So keeping that point in mind, we can replace P by this relation. So the traveling wave is having two waves is the algebraic sum of two waves, incident and reflected. The first term represent Pij represent the traveling wave, and the second one the reflected wave. Here Inj represents the two ports under considerations for the transmission of signals. So now this closed surface integration indicates that the power has to be considered everywhere in this communication network. So that means the power should be considered on this surface, that is inside this top surface and the side wall, and also this transverse plane, perpendicular plane, and these walls, this one, and the complete junction everywhere. So you have to measure the power everywhere and finally add it. So that is what is the consideration here. But practically, we need not to do so much to find this power. So that's why let us go with some assumptions to reduce the complexity of this question. First point, let us assume that the walls of the ports are made up of perfect conductors. Does mean that no wave can enter into a perfect conductor. The skin depth will be zero for a perfect conductor. So delta can be zero. That means the traveling waves, electromagnetic waves, cannot penetrate into the walls at all. So when the waves are not traveling into the walls, so we need not to evaluate or calculate the powers on these walls of the waveguides. We can remove the integrations over these conducting walls of the waveguides from our equation. So this simplifies our discussion. Okay, if you are not integrating over walls, then where are we integrating? So then, if this port is a source, then waves will be propagating in this direction. Then the top, bottom, right side and left side walls are not at all involved with these waves. Then we need to find only the power passing through this plane. This plane is perpendicular to wave propagation. That is, it is transverse in nature. Transverse means perpendicular. See, this plane perpendicular to the wave propagation should be considered for integration. So you have to integrate the power of the wave over this plane, and this power is delivered to the junction. So by omitting the integration on the top wall, bottom wall, and the sides, so we can directly have only one integration for this part. Like this, we can have only one integration for this port this way. So like this, if there are n number of ports, then we can only have n number of integrals for this electromagnetic waves to find the total power. So that means apart from this transverse plane, all integrations over other planes are considered to be. We have assumed that all the walls are made up of perfect conductors. So no integration is required over those walls. our integration is zero over the swell. So therefore, the power required to be evaluated only evaluated only on the transverse planes at the poles. Transverse planes at the poles. Okay. If you evaluate only at the transverse points of the plate, then what about the junction then? Junction is assumed to be lossless. So that also you can include if the point, the junction is assumed to be lossless. So no power loss in the junction, no power loss on the walls. So only power entering the particular port is to be considered. Okay. So under these conditions, we can write that take only the planes. It is not a closed surface, it is an open surface. Take only the integrations over surfaces where two waves are generally existing. One is the wave leaving the surface, another one is the wave entering the surface. The wave leaving may be incident, entering may be reflected, depending upon the nature of the port. So like this, there will be n number of ports. So we have to integrate the quantity within the bracket n number of times. Okay. So S stands for, here S stands for surface area of the transverse plane. So one integration over S represents one integration in one port. Like that, we have to perform n number of integrations for n number of ports. Now, I make one more assumption. What is that one? So before that, I would like to suggest an equation for P and Pij and Pji in terms of electromagnetic fields. So that is given by Lorentz reciprocity theorem. So using the Lorentz reciprocity theorem, we can write that this integration or surfaces for power can be expressed in terms of electric and magnetic field intensities. So from this relation, we can write that P is equal to E cross H. So all of us know that P is the pointing vector, nothing but power density vector. Even though we say power, it's actually power density, watts per meter square quantity, belonging to a traveling wave. So since P is not the power dissipated or stored, since P represents the power of a traveling wave, it is always advisable to represent in terms of electrical magnetic for better understanding. So this relation is called Lorentz reciprocity theorem. Here the first quantity EI cross HJ represents a traveling wave from jth pole to ith pole, whereas the second quantity represents the wave traveling from ith pole to jth pole. Like this, between two poles, there are two waves possible. One is incident, another one is reflected, which will be in opposite directions. Hence, this negative sign for the summation. Right. Now, to simplify this equation further, let us assume that all the poles are short circuited except all the poles are short circuited. What is the meaning of all the ports are short circuited? In every port, the voltage becomes zero. When a particular port is short circuited, current flow is maximum, but voltage is zero. But I keep two ports not shorted, except ith port and jth port. So we shall consider only two ports, ith port and jth port, and rest all other ports be short circuited, so that when a port is short circuited, what happens? So here, so for example, take this diagram. Yeah. Here, if this port is completely short circuited, let us say, then the wave entering here will be completely reflected. Since the ports and junctions are lossless, the entering wave is completely reflected by this short circuit, so that the voltage wave entering and the voltage wave going back both will be equal, so that the total voltage at this port Vn becomes zero. So this port voltage Vn will be having two waves, Vn plus and Vn minus. Vn plus is the incident, Vn minus is the reflected. So both will be equal, because short circuit does not absorb any power. So that's why both get canceled out. So Vn is zero. So that no power is delivered to any of these short circuited ports. So the wave being delivered or energy being delivered to any of these ports is zero, except this ith port and jth port. So my discussion would only be confined to ith port and jth port. So that's why the integration above is now needed to be integrated over only two ports. Right. So I removed the summation. Only two integrations are needed, one for transverse plane at ith port, another for transverse plane at jth port. So that's why, instead of using summation sign, I mention here, that is transverse plane, Ti transverse plane Tj. So Ti is the transverse plane or perpendicular plane to the waves at ith port, Tj is the perpendicular plane at the jth port. Only over these two planes integrations are needed to be performed. So waves will only be traveling between ith port and jth port. So now the subscripts have meaningful definition now for these two ports. Okay. So now further from this equation, you can write that, so one integration So we shall separate these. This way. So the second chair I have taken to the right side. Okay. Depending upon the direction of the wave propagation, so we can measure current to this one. So here in this traveling pad, wave coming from jth port is measured here. So the wave coming from ith port is measured. So EJ cross HI represents wave traveling from ith port to jth port. Similarly, here also the other way. The junction is lossless. Junction is lossless. All the wave going from J to I, without being absorbed by the junction. So now, by assuming these transverse planes are having the same area. Assuming these transverse planes have the same area, that means ds, and in the junction no power is absorbed, correct, and areas are same, then automatically this integration can be omitted or dropped. Then we'll end up with this only, the relation. So forget about the area of the planes. They're assumed to be equal. And in between the two ports, the entire junction is lossless. So that's why the corresponding waves must be equal. So now to introduce Z matrix and Y matrix into this equation, I would like to convert this electric field and magnetic field into voltages and currents. Okay. So that's why I'm going to replace this electric fields and magnetic fields in terms of the corresponding voltage equations. Yeah. So these are the voltage and currents produced by this electric field and magnetic field respectively. So here the into mark indicates the cross product, which is not needed for this V and I. Now, I would like to convert this current IJ into voltage. So that is IJ is given by VJ by ZIJ. So IJ is the current produced at jth port moving into ith port. So IJ, current moving from jth port to ith port. So that's why ZIJ, the impedance offered by the junction for the propagation of the wave from jth port to ith port. See, ZIJ stands for impedance offered by the microwave junction for the wave traveling between J and I, that is from J to I. So that's why IJ is given by VJ by ZIJ. Similarly, converting II from VI, we'll get a similar equation. So now from this, by canceling these terms on both sides, I'm left with, or I can conclude that that IJ. So with this, all these assumptions and uniform nature of the junction, we can prove that ZJI can be equal to ZIJ. That means the impedance of the path between the two junctions and J will be always equal. So what do we call this one? Reciprocity. This is what is called reciprocity. Whether the wave moves from I to J or J to I, the transmission characteristics remain same. That is called reciprocity. And from this, we can write that Z transpose is equal to Z matrix. So this is that it is symmetric. So Z matrix is symmetry. This is the symmetry of Z matrix. So the transpose are interchanging the poles for the source and load doesn't make any changes. Similarly, we can also show that the Y matrix is also symmetric just by modification of one or two points in this derivation. So you can directly conclude that Y matrix is also symmetric because Y is also relation between current and voltage only. So that's why. So that's about it. So for a lossless reciprocal junction, having a predefined transverse reference planes, Y and Z matrices can be taken as symmetric. So that's the proof. Thank you.